Finance, Bob, please. Thank you.
You're just constantly eating. It seems like the only thing, it's hard work and eating. It's like the army, you're Russian weight.
Oh.
You film, you eat, and you film.
Uh-huh. Some people eat to live and others live to eat. So a minister said once.
Can you get to like that? Just eating on the run?
I don't really like it. I tell you, at the end of 3 days, we feel so full of junk.
Mm-hmm. A lot of hamburgers, milkshakes, that's right.
Is that what you eat, junk?
Hamburgers,
yes, hamburgers,
ham sandwiches.
Scotty, you would love that.
I would.
I know you would. That's just your kind of eating.
I know, I agree.
You know what, I'm anxious to understand, how long have you lived in Oak Park? What's kind of represented here at the table?
Well, I think we moved here in about 43, didn't we?
Before I was married.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Before you, oh yeah, she was still in college.
I guess so.
It was when you were in Purdue, mm-hmm. wasn't it?
I think I figured out I lived here 28 years as of 1973. Mm-hmm. The rule of God's beat.
Yeah.
Well, the boys were born here, so that's 19 years and 21 years. And I moved here in 1927, so I have longevity as far as the community.
What do you feel about it? You've lived here, you go back?
Well, I do lock the door when I go away now. But for years we didn't. I didn't choose to even bother locking the car very often, but now I do, but I'm not. That doesn't mean I'm afraid, fear. It's just the thing to do in 1973.
Well, do you think the situation is going to get worse now?
Oh, I think it's going to get better.
Is it related
because
to Chicago?
The ratio of blacks to whites has grown, you know, so rapidly over the last year, hasn't it?
About
11%.
11%
nationally.
Yeah. 2% in Oak Park, Scott.
Oh, that's...
Mother, what would you think would be a good ratio or percentage?
Well, I really haven't given that much thought, but, I presume it's a third, third black to two-third white.
I think the black proportion of the area, not just the city of Chicago, is something about 20%. And if I had to name a figure, I guess that's what I'd name.
About
20%. Why would you name that?
Pardon?
Why would you name that?
Simply because in the larger Chicago metropolitan area, not just the city itself, but the suburbs too, the proportion of blacks is about 20%. And mm-hmm. I think the local community of which I'm a part, that if I had a name of proportion, it would approximate that of the larger community.
I think another interesting question is, when would we, or any of us, at what percentage would we move? When a certain percentage of blacks move in, when would we consider leaving? Not out of fear, just because it's uncomfortable to be in the minority. And I think myself it would be somewhere in the neighborhood between 60% and 80%.
I wouldn't disagree with that, but I think the rate of change is a big factor too. If it had become only 40% but was changing 15% or 20% a year, I might be inclined to leave sooner if I were inclined to leave at all.
You've also got generations here. To leave here, where would you go?
Where would I go?
Where would you go if you left?
Usually families go up west, like to Glen Ellen, or just places like that.
West of Chicago,
yeah.
not the west
where
coast.
Where it's just about totally white, I think.
But then some... Is that where you'd go?
No, I don't know where I'd go. That's just what families do, I think. They just move out there and west.
I think that's true.
Queen Oprah is a big friend.
Yeah, Oprah is a lot.
Some place that's regarded as safe, you know?
I think Elk Grove Village and Arlington and some of those suburbs.
Thank you.
I think that's a that was a strong indication of support. But, you know, on the question of integration, when I was raising around the teacher, around if you have a bad teacher, in all of our statements we said, you know, the community would support the school in integration. And as Mrs. Strode was mentioning, that once, if it's a black teacher that has to be replaced, it becomes a racial problem.
A racial issue over a teacher depends on the amount of confidence most of the people have in the administration and in the principal. And if they, you know, if they trust them to handle any problems that might come up, they'll be minimized, I think.
Yeah. One thing which I think perhaps our organization could be properly concerned with is something which has come up in the past is a sort of publicity campaign to stop what some people have called the bad-mouthing of Oak Park. I mean, make people aware of the fact that you know, even some of the older people who, because their children have left home now, you know, people who are selling their houses, people who have contacts with people who might want to move in, who are moving around, there should be answers. There should be the ability to communicate to people that we do enjoy our neighborhood, we trust our neighborhood.
Well, I think that this is what the Housing Center is trying to do in terms of publicizing the good parts
about
it.
There are people that are not weak. You know, there are people in Oak Park that don't know the Housing Center exists.
Yeah.
And I wonder if we, as a neighborhood, our community organization, we might not, especially through the system that we're trying to get organized, reach everybody in the community.
I think we have to have a means of promoting our neighborhood, and there has to be some kind of stock response, and we have to have the statistics.
Mm.
Is the crime rate in East Oak Park any worse than it is in West Oak Park? I think the answer is no. We have a third more police patrolling in our neighborhood than anywhere else in the village, as of July 4th, I guess, or July 1st or something.
And I noticed that the police force is integrated now, too. The
police force is
many.
Integrated, yeah.
Yeah.
They go well with the brown cars.
We had a whole family discussion on what color those cars are. Are they brown or gold?
Ian, what would you say your maximum rental would be?
145, 150.
Okay. Mm. And when do you need it?
September 1st.
They showed you six.
Yeah.
In Chicago?
No.
Well, we're only open till 4.
Which office are you at? Is this the one
I'm in the city, but I'm in the process of changing jobs.
Okay, this is not to the Elmwood Park office.
No.
Okay. How about, did you call Inland about that studio that they had?
No, well.
All right, I'll give them a call.
There's still a one-bedroom available at Santa Maria, huh?
Do you still have your 3.5 for 145? Okay, how would this afternoon be for seeing the 3.5? Until 7? Okay.
And you'll be busy till about 6:30 or so, and then you can try the other fellow at dinner time.
Okay.
And I'll be here in the morning if you need me.
Great.
I'll try the other
Good luck. And in fact, if you need to reach me this evening, if you call in, there's an answering service. So.
Oh, great. Thanks a lot.
Thank you
okay.
very much.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Good luck.
Thank you.
I'm Bobby Raymond. I'm executive director of the Oak Park Housing Center, located at the First Congregational Church. Matching people up with available housing seems like a very simple kind of effort. It really is a much bigger thing than that, actually. It is trying to keep a community together. To have an integrated community, whites must keep moving into the community. Otherwise, we're simply a transitional community changing from white to black. We have, I think, been very successful in continuing the demand from white families interested in moving to the community. At the same time, our second objective would be to assist minority group families, and primarily blacks, to find housing throughout the community, not be steered to one section of the community, to be limited to one particular neighborhood, but to have access to housing throughout the community, and in fact, if they're interested, to any other community in the area. I think the problem is, in being part of the Chicago metropolitan area, an urban area which has historically seen neighborhoods change on a block-by-block basis, so that people who live in the Chicago area tend to be rather skeptical about any neighborhood, any community in the Chicago area accomplishing stable integration. People who live in Chicago have seen their neighborhoods change drastically over perhaps a short period of time. And I think if we look at Austin as an example of that, Austin, which is close, and many people who live in Oak Park formerly lived in Austin or know someone who lived in Austin, had a relative who lived in Austin, they've seen what happened in Austin in the typical Chicago pattern of racial change, with the accompanying deterioration of services and of schools. And people begin to believe that this is what racial change is all about, that a neighborhood must deteriorate when it changes racially, or that, that there is no such thing as real integration. So, you know, what we have basically is a community with the threat of rapid racial change coming from the east of us, two totally closed communities to the south of us, a relatively closed community to the west of us, another one too expensive really for most blacks to afford, northwest of us, and straight up to the north, another totally white enclave. So here sits Oak Park, a community open, hoping to accomplish stable integration, but suffering a great deal of pressure and anxiety at this point.
If they want that apartment, they should ask for an application. If that application is turned down for invalid reasons or discrimination, which is proven, I think they have a good case. There again, not all white tenants who apply for an apartment are necessarily received.
Well, granting that fact, what we're questioning is whether or not the remedy after the fact of being discriminated against and then coming in for assistance might preclude a qualified tenant from getting an apartment simply because the apartment might be leased in the interim.
What I came here to somewhat object about is putting more burdens in the course of real estate property management within the village. I think everyone's aware property values have not gone up lately.
Well, I'm sure you'd agree that bad management is a hindrance to property values, too, and community welfare. And this is what we're trying to forestall.
That's a hard term to define when you say,
how? Poor management of multiple family dwelling units can lead to neighborhood deterioration and a decline in property values. And this amendment and a lot of others are designed to help forestall that.
Well, you know, once certain forces begin to occur, once processes begin to occur, they have a momentum all their own. And Oak Park is now caught up in that momentum with the demand for middle-class housing on the part of black people. Now, that demand cannot be met within the city of Chicago. And there's been no significant development of moderate and middle-income housing in the city of Chicago in the past several years. And there won't be any in the foreseeable future. The federal government has turned its back on the city, consciously. So that process begins to take place. Now, because Oak Park is located right next door to the city, it's got to be caught up in that process. The question is whether Oak Park, because its form of government is more accessible, can control the momentum that that process carries with it. And it seems to me the whole test in Oak Park is whether those handles of government, because they're more accessible than they are in a large city, can be used in a suburb to solve what are usually thought of as urban problems.
I have received at least one telephone call from Mr. William Robinson asking if he could appear this evening to speak to the general subject of management practices. I indicated that it would be an agenda item and that he would be welcome to talk.
And I personally would like to speak to a little bit of the things that happen when a community changes. There's generally the air that can relate directly to me because I am black, that, okay, everything is going to go down. There's an air of panic. There's an air of, okay, we've got to leave now before our property values get so low we can't reasonably sell out. But the thing is that here you have black people moving into your community, and we are just as much concerned about what's happening in the community as the former residents or the present residents. Now, we have a situation on the corner of Austin and Jackson. It's located in Southeast Oak Park, but the problems that were caused there are not caused by black. But it is still community deterioration. The lawn on the outside has been run down. The general condition of the hallways is blighted and dangerous. The building does require us to have some serious and immediate type attention.
Right, it's a question of upkeep, it's a question of screening, it's an overall management question, etc. It leads one to believe that the situation has been that the main thing they want out of the building is the money. Who cares what happens to the community or what the people are like or whether they can... the main thing is to keep the building filled.
The problem here is people are not satisfied with the way the owner is running the building. So I think we have to get after the owner and tell him what we are expecting here.
We're here to protest the action which has been taken and the inaction of its present owner. As we understand, Chicago Federal Savings and Loan Association, and in particular, their attorney, Mr. Culhane, who is a vice president of the firm and has acted on their behalf in various village proceedings.
No attempt was made to make repairs on the building until a couple of days before May 3rd. The judge at that time gave Mr. Winston and or Chicago Federal a 30-day extension. The second hearing was on June 7th of 1973. At this time, the case was dropped by the village because the bare minimum of the housing code had been met. In an informal meeting in the hall outside of the courtroom, a group of us talked to Mr. Culhane, the lawyer representing Chicago Federal at both hearings. I asked Mr. Culhane for the second time to meet with concerned citizens of our neighborhood to discuss what the plans for the building were. Mr. Culhane informed me that he would not meet with us, that the bank owned similar buildings on Chicago's west side, and that if he started this, that he would spend all of his time in meetings, and that furthermore, he had no responsibility whatsoever to this community.
You've got a landlord in absentia here. Mm-hmm.
We
don't even know who it is. We send
our
check.
It's hard to find out. It's the bank.
They still
own it? I'm sure they do. Yeah. They foreclosed on it, and they haven't been able to pay it.
And we're selling it to one fellow on contract. That's still a bad situation.
This guy
is trying to get out because the community is applying too much pressure to him to...
What do you mean you don't know who the landlord is?
We mail our check to a savings and loan association, who in fact I assume has a legal, let's say, control of the property. You never see them here, right? They could care less. And so do the people that are in terms of managing the building. They could care less.
You watch most neighborhoods that have undergone racial change. A lot of the elements of blight were present before blacks arrived. But then the instant a significant percentage of blacks moved in, people suddenly noticed that there were a lot of things that had to be done. Now, one of these things I think we've got going for us is that we've noticed that, and we're acting about it right now. In the next 18 months, Oak Park is going to be pouring $4.5 million into that end of town through a new civic center, new median strips, and a revitalization of the business area. Now that, to me, is the way to spend the people's money wisely. I think that investment's going to be repaid and repaid and repaid. What good would it be, for example, to have a lot of policemen walking past empty storefronts? You can feel safe in a ghost town, but it's not a very nice place to live. They're going to have to rehabilitate those buildings. They're going to have to seek ways to explore with the village to buy adjacent properties and turn those into parking areas. or they just won't be able to compete with other suburban apartments. And if they don't, they'll become vacant. And if they stay vacant very long, they'll begin to be occupied by anybody who can walk in the door and pay rent for a month or two. And it's that kind of thing that will cause the surrounding single-family homeowners to run.
My name is George Manos. I'm a Greek-American living in Oak Park, Illinois. I used to live in Austin, where this church is, for 15 or more years. I had a cleaning business in this area, and I tried my best, as much as I could, with the OBA, trying to convince the people in this area, which was 60%, I'll say, Greeks, to convince them not to panic, to run away when one black or two black families moved in the neighborhood. But still the people were saying yes, they're not panicking, and they were selling. And this happened because of the panic of the people running away when one black moved in the neighborhood of Austin. The building that I bought, and I have no part, the store downstairs and apartment upstairs. Now I have rented it. I have 5 years lease. The 2.5 years lease is over. What I'm worried about is, as soon as the lease is over, who's going to rent my store so I can pay off my mortgage? What am I going to do with my savings of all my life I put in there? And from there, I was waiting to have a good retirement. And if my tenant, at the end of the 5 years, doesn't want to stay there more because of the panic that every other people have and because the blacks are in there, what's my position? What am I going to do? This is what concerns me more, the economic. And this is what concerns all the people, the economic situation. What are we going to do? Why should we lose the money that we put in, the savings of our lives? And that's what I'm concerned about. What am I going to do next? I remember when the blacks reached Cicero Avenue, the whites were moving from Laramie. When the blacks just reached Laramie, they were moving from Austin. 10, 15 blocks away, they were moving. Where are we going to stop? Are we keep on going running? Where? To the farms? Even the farms are full of suburbs and cities now. How far more out are we going to go? 50, 60, 100 miles to come back in our jobs in Chicago or in the big cities? And this is not a local problem. I hope that the federal government and all the governments see it and put an end to that running and panicking away.
What people need to understand when a community goes, quote, unquote, is the word for it, all black when it changes, is not that it's a black family that's moving in. It is not a black problem. It is a white problem. It is caused by, partially, by the white families who are panicking and running out and their lack of understanding. But even more so than that, I would blame it on a white bureaucracy, a white establishment, a white system who pulls its services out of the community, as is happening here as far as money, pulls its money out of the community. We had trouble getting a loan. People cannot move into an area if you can't get a loan. That has nothing to do with the black families moving in. That has to do with the white bureaucracy that causes this problem. For instance, we made a complaint 4 months ago that we were asked to file against the bank who brought up the terms for this house. And so far, there has been no action on that complaint yet. Now, that's 4 months with a very serious complaint, or at least we were told it was serious. I don't know enough about the legal ramifications of the whole thing to say whether it's a good court case or a poor court case, because I don't understand all that, but we were told that it was, for redlining, which is a very difficult thing to deal with, a pretty good case.
Dates? No, I don't. I didn't sell them the house. I don't know.
They had trouble getting a mortgage, went to three banks. They mentioned a word that I have confused, redlining. Yeah. What is redlining?
Well, they say redlining is when the savings and loans take an area, like maybe, let's say, from Austin Boulevard to 12th Street to Ridgeland to Madison, and they say, we don't want to make conventional loans in there. They can't come out and say this, it's against the law. But what they do is that they lowball the property. For example, if we sell it for $20,000 and we want a 80% loan, therefore they would have to come with an appraisal of $20,000, they might say, well, it's worth 18.
What do they gain by redlining?
Well, the only thing is that they feel that when they redline, if they take an area that's bad, that they feel that they are can make better loans out west in newer buildings, and this is what they'd rather do, because they are afraid that if an area does go, they might be holding a building, a mortgage on a building where the mortgage is almost as high as the value of the property if the neighborhood changes.
We feel that the houses are not being shown on the street, for instance. We know families who have had their homes up for sale for a year and a half, mm-hmm. year and a half. And the houses have been shown 3 or 4 times. I can't believe that that many people that are coming in specifically say, I don't want to live on Humphrey, which is a block from Austin.
We have a few of those people that are very bigoted, I guess you could call it. But those people, I tell them when they come in here. They come in and they say, oh, this is going to be all black, or this is going to be all black. And I tell them, I says, you go find the place where you're going to be safe. If I knew where it was, I'd send you. But I says, when you find that place, you tell me where it is. Because you've got them in Elk Grove Village, you've got them in Lombard, you've got them in Wheaton, you've got them in Glen Ellen, you've got them in Northbrook, you've got them in Deerfield, where else? So these people, that they right away say, I don't want to be near any black. I can't see where you could go. And as far as those people that are biggest, we had those 6, 7, when I went in business in Oak Park, they said to me many times, I can remember showing houses on the West End. They said, don't bring those people back, they're Jews. I don't want them. Now, what happened? We've got a synagogue over there now, and now they're accepted, they're fine. But this is how things change.
Yeah, and the specific reason that we moved to Oak Park is that one of our children is black. Our youngest son, Michael, is adopted, and he is black. And that puts us in the unique position of wanting and needing for the sanity and survival of our own family an integrated community. And that's the specific reason why we moved to the 600 block of South Humphrey in Oak Park. The block itself is fantastic for us and for our family, although we do see a lot of pressure on this block. There's a lot of pressure in our everyday lives to change the block that we think is ideal for our particular family. And I think the thing about Oak Park in particular, as opposed to Chicago, Chicago, I suppose, is a classic example of how blockbusting techniques, how they worked, how they operated. And I think Oak Park is different because it's a much tighter-knit community. It's a more controlled environment. There are too many people in Oak Park that are totally aware and totally concerned about what's happening in Oak Park. And I once heard it said that the way Chicago went is that one day the people woke up and their neighborhood had turned into a ghetto. And everything was gone before people knew it. It was like some neighborhoods just deteriorated so fast. And I don't think that'll happen in Oak Park. I've seen a great deal of evidence that Oak Park can make it as an integrated community, a successfully integrated community. One of the things that particularly gives me hope is that Oak Park has created all of the structures and mechanisms and resources that they need to deal with the problems. They have a housing commission. They have a community relations group. They have citizens programs. They have local real estate organizations. They do have local financial organizations. However, our particular stake here in Oak Park, this is the last place that we have to go with our family. We looked all over Chicago, and this is the only place that seemed to hold any promise for us. We have no place else to go other than this street right here.
I want to need another one like this.
Okay, there's one of those for you.
I need another one like this.
Okay, try that one.
Look.
You see
see that, Michael?
That one first.
That's pretty good, isn't it?
Go get me another one.
What kind do you need?
Oh,
it's time. Okay, wait, now, all right, put a green stick in there.
All right, now I need...
Put a green stick in there.
It won't be the same.
Well, that's okay.
What do you need, Christy?
I want the same.
The same. Well, how about instead of using the blue stick,
why don't you put a green stick right in there?
Two green sticks.
Daddy,
yeah,
I need one of these,
but
I can't get
these.
I put one of these into.
All right, put it in there.
Okay,
oh, put the green
can
one right in there.
Can I give me only one?
All right, here, let Daddy hold it.
Daddy.
Daddy,
what
hold
do you
want?
I
okay.
Want
very good.
I can't get
the other
one.
Michael, what is that, Michael?
What is it?
I don't know.
You don't know? You built it, didn't you?
Oh, this one on, too.
Oh, well.
This one, but I'll never get...
Here, put that one on there.
No, I can't fit.
Well, put it on the other way. I'll put it on sideways.
Take one.
Sound, Mike. Yeah, that's it. Sound, yeah.
Take one.
Good. Could you tell us the fact that you started teaching 4 years ago and you were the first black teacher? And you would have followed.
Mm-hmm. I really don't want to say that. First black teacher.
You were the first black teacher in the community?
Are you tied on film now?
Yeah.
Yeah, but I don't want to relate to that. That part particularly, you know. Let's see. When I walk in the door in the morning to teach here at school, I don't think to myself, here's Janet Wells, the black teacher. I just feel, here's Janet Wells, the teacher. And I think that if I did not have that feeling and that belief and conviction, I couldn't function. But no matter how secure you are and no matter what good experiences you've had, sometimes if you go into a restaurant and the waitress is rather unpleasant, you must maintain your control and think first, maybe, at least we do, or maybe she had a bad day. The last thing that we want to think is that she just doesn't want to wait on us. When we move, we have to consider that we might have to sell the house in a couple years or so. We know through our own experiences that it's very difficult for blacks to sell houses because of the fact that the market is limited. In other words, we'd probably only be able to or have success with selling to another black family. So therefore, we choose an area where our house would probably sell a little better. We felt that we wanted a variety of folks living around us. And we find that in Oak Park, we seem to have that to a degree, because in newer areas, there'd be a lot of maybe first homeowner families, and it would just be different for us. No matter what the economic situation is, we have to consider whether or not we will be comfortable in a situation. I'm just blank. I don't know why.
Sorry. Let's take a break. Janet, the problem is that these films have been made on and off through the years in the 60s and the 70s with various degrees of compromise.
Mm-hmm.
This time we have a chance. The community is going through a change. Mm-hmm. If we can talk straight, the community will come to face itself.
Yeah, I know what you mean about talking straight, but see, when I say on a film that I wish there were more black families here, I realize at the same time that if there are a lot more black families here, I have to get out.
Why do you have to get out of
the Well, because the white people are going to run and the schools are going to go to pot and I can't get anything for the house. But see, that is very, very strong, you know. But, I mean, we've lived through this, but I'm sitting here and I know what you mean about truth, but sometimes it is too raw for me to stand up to.
Is an integrated community possible?
You want to know the truth?
Yeah.
Now, no. Maybe 15 or 20 years from now, when whites are convinced that blacks are just as good as, and they have more exposure to black people who are like them, who can speak English, and who can think, and who can work. Because they think we're all one stereotype alike.
What would you like to say to us? A challenge, a request, a question to what?
You know, I mean, I'm trying, I know what you want, but...
People have to stop running.
Well, yeah, well, that's
black people thing. Run too. That makes us mutually frightened.
Mm-hmm.
Now, how do we stop running? Do we intermarry? Do we forget? What do we do?
You know, you're trying to. Oh man! Oh wow! What do we do?
Somebody's got to be the first person.
To what?
To stop.
To stop them? Mm-hmm. Yes, you're right.
All right, I'm going to ask what it is we can do when we turn on the camera. A chance now to talk directly to Oak Park.
Mm-hmm. Give me a minute, okay? Yeah. When I think specifically about Oak Park and the fact that all of us who live here want Oak Park to stay the way it is, as far as all those conveniences that we have are concerned, I consider also what has happened in other places where we've lived. And I know that as soon as blacks start coming in any number, whites start running out. Perhaps I could say a lot of things like, go visit black families and see how they live, and you'll see that they're just as human as you. Or I might say to you, read some black history, or talk to the woman who works for you, you know. But I really think that it has to go beyond that, because to me, so many of those things are just superficial, and most of us have passed that way and have very little tolerance or interest for those kinds of things. I think we have to come to grips with ourselves personally and stop being afraid. And maybe that's just basic, and just decide that we're not going to go. I think that there's too much here to run away from, and I think it's foolish. And there must be some way that people can live together here. And we're all charged with doing something about that. I can't tell you how. I can only tell you how I feel about it. I'm empty.
I'm Sherilyn Reed, and I'm the wife of Henry Reed, and I've been that way for about 15 years. We grew up as kind of childhood sweethearts off and on.
Yeah.
Been like this all day.
You know, the people will be here pretty soon.
Okay.
You gotta come down.
Yeah, I gotta just finish up over here.
What's that?
I think one of the first things that I realized was the difference between how I was accepted in Detroit and how I was accepted when I came to Oak Park.
No.
I moved in to Detroit in November, and no one spoke to me until about March on my block. Going out and coming in, people would pass me and not say anything, or I'd see people and they'd not speak. And that was kind of frightening because my children were very young, and I thought, if I needed somebody, who would I call?
You haven't mentioned how you feel since that.
I can remember, you know, at about 9 years old when my mother and three of her sisters and sister-in-laws walked into a movie show in Homestead. And the man said, go upstairs, and they walked straight and sat downstairs. And even in those days, our parents were fighting it, fighting the racism, you know, in their own way.
Adjusting.
Meals haven't been on time.
And I don't think black folks really have the luxury of being racist. It's just something that you can't be, because our whole lives have been built around white people. And what white people have done and what white people have set up as examples.
Yeah, if you plan it, then you can probably put it together, too.
All right, you're coming down.
Yeah, I'll be down in a few minutes.
Slumber party.
Who's slumber party?
Mayor Karen, she didn't tell me.
Oh, she didn't tell you.
Mm-hmm. The front of the fender is out in the, on the driver's side.
Oh,
thanks.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well.
Daddy, do you know my lights are broken?
Yeah, we got it fixed.
I got the muffler fixed.
Did you? Yeah. Good.
And said our what are broken?
One of my lights.
The south side, the muffler was almost rotted away. So.
Oh. So did you fix the exhaust pipe?
Yeah.
And the muffler?
And the muffler, yeah.
Oh, the muffler wasn't on.
I saw it, honey. It was terrible.
It had holes in the muffler?
Yeah, it was a mess.
Ah! Mm. No!
I guess the main reason that we believe in integration is because there really is no other way to bring our children up in this world. It is a white man's world. They're in charge of everything. That's just real.
About my
10 o'clock, what time do you get there?
3 hours.
And in order for our kids to make it, they have to be able to deal with the man who is going to be at the top when they get there. And they can't do it living in another world that they haven't dealt with him.
No, you don't have to be there any time because we're driving you.
I know, but if you're taking the bus, you have to be there 7.
When we try to talk about being black and what it's like to be black and what it feels like, the time you really feel it is when you're out there, you know, on the mainstream with other white people. And, you know, you sense their insecurity at having you around. One of you is tolerable, but if there's more, even though you may not be together, that's extremely threatening. We feel it as blacks, the fact that you're threatened. It's a constant thing that you keep asking, why? Why am I threatening to you when you're in the majority? Why am I shaking you up when you've got everything? I'm not asking for anything you have. I'm not trying to get anything you've got. And yet, I'm shaking you up. That is so unnecessary, because we're frightened to death in a situation of all of you.
I board the L at the first stop in the loop at Jackson and Wabash, and I usually leave the office for the L about 5 o'clock, 5:15. And ride to Oak Park, which takes about 15, 20 minutes.
I should leave, you know, this tremendous wealth and power that you see. You get a sense of not only the successes of the city, but its failures as well. Slum, the ghetto, worn out buildings, the broken windows, sandwiched in and neglected and forgotten by most, mainly to be thought of with a food basket at Thanksgiving or Christmas time, and a place to refer one's used clothing. All of the negatives of society jump out at you very quickly. You know who's being exploited, and it gives you a feeling of uncomfortableness because the deprivation that comes out of it is so severe, and it seems most cruel.
A lot of days it's more than what you want to cope with, and
you know their struggle for survival in our kind of a society, which has his foot really on the neck of blacks rather than offering a helping hand, picking yourself up by your bootstraps is impossible if you don't have any damn boots to put on. It tends to remind you of how content America is to deny this vast human potential the opportunity to develop.
I've often wondered, what could I do? All avenues of thoughts and fantasies seem to run into dead ends. America is built on money, and money is power. And blacks individually, whether they have good intentions and good motives, they don't have the one essential to bring about change, which is money. Brings about power.
I think now I'm more aware that, I'm the black cat who is identified as having abandoned a brother in the city. And I don't really see that. I think that I have a right to live, any place in the land that my dollars can buy. And as I move up, the black cat on the bottom is going to be able to move up. That I really haven't run away from the brother in the ghetto. I might be two paces ahead of him. And I imagine that's a very real fear for a lot of people all over the country.
The question that's always asked, people say to you, well, do you think Oak Park's going to make it? And I always respond to that by saying, well, how do you define making it? Now, what's making it to you? Making it to a lot of people is keeping blacks out. That's what most people mean when they say, do you think we're going to make it? And if they define making it as that, the answer is no. If they don't think that any degree of older housing or any degree of tension or any degree of problems constitutes making it, then they should find the dullest, safest, most plastic suburb they can and move there. That suburb, by their definition, will make it. My definition of Oak Park making it is simply Oak Park doing what it's doing now. I think Oak Park is making it right now. It's making it by illustrating that individual people can raise enough hell with institutions to have some effect on the momentum of social process. And making it is proving that you can absorb newcomers into the mainstream of a community and have the older portions of the older traditions of the community enrich them and be enriched by the presence of the newcomers. Now, to me, that's making it.
Now, to other people, that's a life of constant tension and turmoil. But to me, that's the only way to live.
Concentrate. Relax. Relax. Okay, contraction begins. Okay, 15.
No, if I need it, could you put it on me? I can't do it. I tried it. My Puccini ended up doing it for me.
I still think it's the girl.
Mm-mm.
It's the girl.
Good.
Yeah, I can tell.
Nope.
What do you have, Mom?
Boy.
What?
Be another boy.
No, Dr. Spassky is a daughter. He thinks it's terrific.
They are. But I'm not saying what it is. I don't make any guesses.
I mean, he's just not going to guess.
Yeah, sure, but I get vibes, you know.
Okay, let's go now, big boy. I'm just going to put on a little.
There we go. Keep pushing.
That's the way.
Oh, well.
something. That's it. Take a breath. Come on.
That's the way. That's it. All right. Another big one. Oh, that's real. Okay, we'll
relax.
Everything's coming just fine. No problem.
Thank you. Is it all right, Dr. Smith?
Oh, everything's fine.
Oh, good.
Everything's fine, just...
Yeah, I am fine.
Push like crazy, you know.
Oh,
it's too easy, yeah.
I'll try.
No, you're doing fine.
Take a deep breath.
Okay.
I don't think the contractions are real strong right now, though, is it?
Yeah.